Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the series of MLOps with MLflow. We will make an experiment with Databricks, MLflow, and Octuna. Octuna is another hyperparameter optimization library. And well, similarly to what we did with HyperOd, it's a pretty similar technology. We will do an experiment, but this day using this other library. We will work today as well with Databricks. I will show you how to work with these libraries inside this powerful environment, Databricks. We are working in Azure. You need to replicate this experiment to set up a workspace in Azure or in Google Cloud or in Amazon. You can get a trial for 15 days free. Just to try, and then it's a full version of the Databricks with all the functionalities that are available. The only limitation is that you cannot set up GPUs, GPU clusters, and then, well, it's for some experiments, it could be a little bit limited. You need to work with GPUs. You can do it in the community, Databricks Community Edition, in another website, in another page, and then you can set up a GPU, a small cluster, but with a GPU. Okay, so first thing we need to do is, well, obviously set up the workspace in Azure. In the previous video, there is videos already on the channel how to do this. So we are not going to cover that. You also need a computer, a cluster. In that case, this is also in the channel. We will not cover as well that. The only thing we will cover is that in this specific exercise, we need to install some libraries because they are not part of the Databricks runtime. We are using, as you can see here, the version 15.1 machine learning. So to verify what you had on the, you can go to the release notes. I will put this on the notebook. The notebooks later on I will upload it to the repository as usual, and then you can verify and read the documentation I will provide together with this experiment and notebooks. So every release contains different libraries, obviously libraries for Python, R, or Java and Scala, the languages supported in Microsoft, in Databricks. So if you have a GPU runtime, also you have this CUDA toolkit in this case, 12.2, a Tensor RT for TensorFlow H6. Check it out. It is match with the requirement you have for your project when you install or set up a new cluster. So there is also some main libraries, depending which the runtime you are using. These libraries may vary and have different versions. So I recommend you to review the release notes to understand which ones you have installed in your runtime. So later also you had the Python libraries. This applies to any cluster. So you had three different blocks. One is this one apply only to the GPU clusters. That one apply to the ML, everything that you see here, up to Python, which is basically only for Python, which apply to also to the CPU clusters, not without Conventional runtimes, and then only you scroll down, you will find as well specific libraries for R and exactly specific libraries for R and for Java and Scala. And then, as the library of Tuna is not included on the libraries available on this runtime, we need to come here to libraries and install a new one. You just simply come here, you can have the package as a wheel or as a package, a distribution, a package distribution with the compatible with PIP. You can upload it to your workspace. You can make a path. You can get a file from the Azure Data Lake. In this case, we are in Azure. You can also point to a path in the data lake via PIP, Maven if you are using Java or Scala, CRUN if you are using R, and Database File System if you have it in another location in your workspace. You simply can go to PIP, just put the version here of Tuna, and equal the version that you want to install. This is like that for any library that you want to install that is not included on the runtime. Also, if you want to update one of the libraries, it's not recommended. The libraries that come in the runtime, it's not recommended to update them because you can essentially break the compatibility of the different components that you have in the runtime. But you can install it using the libraries, the install new button. But again, it's not Database doesn't recommend to do it like that. Also, they don't recommend to install it via PIP. You can do it as well on the notebook, but it's not they don't recommend to do it like this. Database runtime release notes. Then you can take a look here just for that. You can check whatever version you have here, all the versions that are not yet deprecated. What more? Octuna is a hyperparameter optimization framework, very similar to the one we saw days ago. HyperOpt is also working with Bayesian optimization, also available different algorithms to do this, and then you can take a look to the documentation. We will cover a sample here. You will see it's pretty easy to use and come with also a dashboard, but this dashboard we will not use it. We will use MLflow, but if you want to use the dashboard that come with Octuna, you can do it as well if you plan to run this locally. In fact, to run this notebook in your local environment, you don't need to do many changes. Just simply, I will show you now this how you can replace it. But the rest, essentially, you can run it practically in a Jupyter notebook without any problem, because all those libraries are Python libraries. They are not Spark libraries, so all of them can be. We are using only Python libraries, so you can run it on local. Depending on your computer, well, it will take more or less time. Anyway, Octuna is quite efficient, so it's run relatively quickly. So here I tested 500 trials with this new data set. We are going to do a regression problem, and 500 trials took 15 minutes. So the data set is not very big, obviously, and then well, the only reason to do it here is because we don't need to install Emmerflow. It's not, you can use, like in previous videos, the infrastructure is in data in Dockers. There is also a video in the channel that explains how to run the Emmerflow in Docker containers, and also it's not, you can run it like I did in other videos in a Colab notebook, and export the tracking server port using NGR or okay. Okay, well, here due to do it more quickly, I use Databricks, and this way I can also show you some tricks here in Databricks. This is one of the examples. So not the libraries I create, so not the functions. I just put it in another notebook. There are this function to generate synthetic data, and some functions to plot some graphs that we will use later in the optimization experiment. Feature important, residuals and correlation plot. And also here, this is simply a method to create synthetic data. It's going to be random, so don't be, how to say, don't expect to get very good outcomes of this experiment because it's fake data. And then that's why I wanted to do it with the Faker, sorry, with this library to generate synthetic data. But yeah, in terms of the, it's not the objective of this video to show you how to do regression with XGBoost. The purpose is to show you how these tools works together: Databricks, Emmerflow, and Optuna. So to run this notebook, probably you know that, but well, if you want to run a notebook and be part all the content of the notebook, in this case are five methods, five functions, to be part of the main one. This is the one that you are showing now in the screen. You just need to do a run with this format. This is a magic. I'm just using the magic cell run, and you just point to the notebook without PI, without anything. It just you get the absolute path. You can also, if you are in the same notebook, these two notebooks are in the same folder, Emmerflow with Optuna and Utils. You can also make a relative path here, that slash Utils, but well, I prefer always to do it with absolute paths. And then once you run it, now everything that you had there is like if you do here in a conventional Jupyter notebook. From Utils, import or import from Utils, import star. This means that all the methods that you have in Utils are already imported to our memory space, or to the memory space of this notebook. If you didn't see the previous videos I did with Databricks, as we are using here Python libraries, this cluster have two work one driver and one worker, which means we have two workers and one driver. The driver and worker of the driver also contains a worker, but as we are using purely Python libraries, we will not use the worker because all these libraries only run on the driver. So yeah, well, we import it, we run the utils, and here we just generate a data frame. It's simply we try to forecast the demand of apples from some specific parameters like temperature, rainfall, the day of the week, if it is holiday or not, the price per kilogram, if there is a promotion in the stores or not, the demand, the previous day's demand, this is the target. This is the previous day's demand, this is the average of the, let me remember how it's done. Previous day demand. It was it's the demand of the day before. Competitor price per kilogram and marketing intensity. No, don't forget that in any case this data is fake, synthetic, so it's just something that we created for this experiment. You can vary here these two parameters, and obviously what you are going to get in your computer when you run it is going to be absolutely different from what we had here in my computer. We can here we examine the correlations in between the target and the other predictors. So you can see here we are going to run it again. You will see that it's going to be different. Okay, so that's one. We run the method correlation plot. Plot correlation with demand. Check it out here. Maybe we obtain the same, but you have now this on the video. If we now run it again. Oops. This is. Well, since that it is the same, let's change this to, for example, 9000. Okay. We generate this and let's check it out. Well, it's exactly as a previous day of semana. Yeah, it's changing a little bit the plot in comparison with the previous one. Okay, here we use another method that we have on utils. It's just to create an experiment. It doesn't exist, it's not returning the experiment ID. This that you have here is pretty simple. If you get the experiment using the name, if you have it, you just return experiment ID, which is the ID of the experiment in the database. If not, we create an experiment. And creating an experiment, in any case, if you create the experiment, it return the ID, and if you get it, you just return the ID from the object that you got from the database. Here we just prepare, we set the experiment, and here we are just dropping to the date, which is at that date time, and the demand, obviously, because this is the target value, and we assign to Y the demand value. Here we split the data set and we create the D matrix for XGBoost. Let's do it again. And here I'm just running the baseline. Well, why? You are gonna see that here with the four values, we are gonna get practically the same that the optimization will do. This is a good practice when you are doing a hyperparameter tuning exercise and to evaluate always if it was successful or not the algorithm improving the performance of the model. Is always a good practice is to do a evaluation with the same data set that you are going to use in the hyperparameter tuning. Do it before, but with the four parameters. As you see here, we just use the objective, which is in this case, as is regression, is the rec square error, and we use a regression evaluation metric. If you are doing another experiment, like a classification, this had to change, you can go here to objectives, objective, this is 1 second, yeah, objective. Let's check, you have, depending on the type of reverse democratic demo code. custom objective function. Yeah, you have here, but this is customized objective function. This is not what I'm trying to find. Let me check where we had this. Let me one second. Exactly. Learning task parameter objective. You had all these objectives depending. We are using the booster object, so you need to specify the objective. Depending the type of the problem that you want to solve, you will choose one or the other or among the available you have. As you can see, HBoost is quite functional. You have a lot of things that you can do with HBoost, so it's that's why it's so popular. And depending on the objective that you choose for your problem, you need to choose a coordinate metric to evaluate the performance of the model. So we do here a default evaluation, MSC and RMSE, which is the one that we are showing here. Error, that is again MSE and mean square error and RAM mean square error. Okay. This is with the default parameters. Now here we just set up all the errors, the login. We create a callback. The callback is only going to log the metrics and the percentage of improvement only for those experiments among the trials that are improving the metric. If they are not improving the metrics, we don't bring anything. It's a callback. There is many, you can create, this is a custom callback, but you can also use some of the ones that you had available directly in Octuna, call to the tutorial. One of the most useful is the early stopping. You set up a patient, then when, if there is no improvement after end trials, the experiment stop too, because probably we got a local minima and the algorithm is unable to leave this valley or this mountain, this valley. So you probably know that all these algorithms based in Bayesian optimization and in other techniques, usually you get a good local minima, but it's very difficult, when not impossible, to get the global minima of the function. But yeah, and this is one of the, in quotas, weakness of this optimization. But in general, usually this Octuna or Ray or Hyperot used to improve the performance of the algorithm. The idea of doing this initial experiment with the default values is just to evaluate it. It was worth it to run the hyperparameter tuning or not, and decide if you had a problem with the data or you had a problem with the design of your algorithm, or maybe the algorithm itself is not suitable for to solve this kind of problem. So if you get very bad values here and the improvement after hyperparameter tuning is not or it's just a small improvement from the bad values, this means that probably you had a design or a data problem. And hyperparameter tuning is not going to do anything. You are only going to spend money for nothing. And then that's why it's always important to do a correct data exploratory analysis and evaluate the performance of the base model without any optimization, because Usually, like Edgy Bush is very well designed and can give you a fair output just with the default parameters. And then in this case, don't expect that, even that, because the data is fake, so you cannot do this. But as a general rule or as a good practice, try to do it that way. So we create the champion, we create the objective function. You saw the video of Hyperod, also in Databricks. You see that we create our search space, similarly to what we did in Hyperod. We just define objective and metric, and here we suggest categorical is one of the methods when you have categories. Here is like booster, can be GB-tree, GB-linear or Dart. We here lambda, which is a float. Alpha is a float, and only when you have GB-tree or booster, you can choose mass depth, is an integer, ETA, float, gamma, float, and group policy categorical. You can see it's very simple to categories, integers, floats. That's it. If you want to do the scale is logarithmic or non logarithmic. And then on here, well, this is simply train the model with the parameters that you create in this trial, validate and calculate the mean square error and the round mean square error. Root mean square error, sorry. And here you log pair trial, parents, error, and RMSE. You saw here we are using MLflow star run with nested equal true. This means that all these experiments, the trials, will be handled under the main one, which is this is the previous one from my video in Spanish. So you will have, this is the main, and under the main you will have all the different trials with the different versions of parameters. And then, okay, let's move. So you are returning error, the error is mean square error, so we are going to minimize the error. Here we just create a experiment name, which is going to be, sorry, a run name, which is going to be the apple demand with a timestamp. And here, with MLflow start run, we get the name of the experiment. We got it some cells about the run name and nested equal true. This is going to generate the root experiment, and all the ones that will be generated with the objective function will be hanging under this one. So that's why we put here as well nested equal true. This is going to create this kind of login into MLflow. So you see in the objective function we are just logging the metrics and parents, so we are not logging any model or any picture. And then on here we will do that only on the with the best model. Here we set up, we create the study, the experiment in Nocturna. You have the parameter direction. Here you cannot choose minimize or maximize depending on the characteristics of the metrics that you want to optimize. In this case it's a loss, it's an error, so you need to minimize. But case, for example, in the previous video where we use Hyperod, we were using as a metric, it was a classification problem, and we use ROC. In that case you can set up here, if you want to do it with Octuna, you can set up maximize there. And then on we call the optimize function in Octuna. We use the objective function, number of trials, and the callback. The callback you will see now is only 200 trials. After the study finish, we just take the best parameters, we log it to the MLflow, we log the best MSE and the best RMSE. We also set some tags. You can later use the tags to identify projects or search for sorry projects experiments inside the MLflow database. And then on here we train the model with the best parameters and plot the correlation plot that we plotted about. And here we create the feature importance, the residuals. And the residuals, and we log them. Once we logged all the plots, we log the model flavor HBus here. We are not using PigWebFun here, and then on here we are getting the URI of this artifact. Later I will show you how to do this as well. So let me, I don't remember if I run this. Just in case, we are going to run this as well. So I remember I did it, and where we start the process again. So it's going to take like 5-7 minutes. So here, see, again, only the trials with where Octuna is improving the metric will be shown here. The rest are mute. You can see here, you see trial 10 is improving. 0.95%, so practically nothing. Okay, let them go. Again, it's running. You can go to experiment now. You see, we create this one already two. Well, a lot of them already. And if you can enter in one of them, you can check the parameters used on this trial and the metrics. You don't have anything more. So, okay, let's start here, and then once it's finished, so here you can see here 49% of improvement, blah, blah, blah. Okay, later when it's finished, I will continue with the video. Okay, this is already done. It took, let me check, around about 5 minutes. We go to the main one, 5.1 minutes, and in the main one you have here the best parameters, the best RSME, the best MSE, which in comparison with the ones we got in the baseline, but even worse, if I know. Mamma mia. Yeah, exactly, even worse. Yeah, it's expected that because, as I said, this is a fake data, so you cannot expect to get anything, anything correct here. In any case, the objective was not to in a correct regressor, a fantastic regressor to solve the problem, because here essentially there is no problem to solve. And then in any case you can choose you have a data set, for example Titanic or something like that. There are many available to solve regression problems, or house prices in is very common as well for regression problems in many competitions. You can use it with exactly the same. The only thing that you need to change here is here in the prepared dataset, drop the colors that you don't want to use and use the correct target for your dataset. You will see that in that case it will go better than in this case. Okay, that's all. Here we use the model URI. The model URI essentially is that one. You can do the same using the run that no to dictionary, sorry, and here you had all the data that you need where are logging the artifacts, the UID, etc., etc. And here we are just simply doing a prediction with the new model. We use the X, which is exactly, and we are going to create a new column in the data frame, which is predicted demand, and you can expect anything very satisfactory for this. Yeah, the difference are really, really high. Yes. Okay. But again, that was not the purpose. The purpose was to show you how to work with Octuna, MLflow, and Databricks. And yeah, I think that you had an idea grasp of how to do it. Pretty simple. The Octuna is quite very easy to use. MLflow is completely fully integrated in Databricks. In fact, as you know, now Databricks are the maintainers of the MLflow, so that's why I choose this environment to show you this stuff. Here as well, the artifacts, you see this lock the model in UVG format, is an Echibus format, the correlation plot, importance, and residuals. Terrible. But okay, again, it's fake data. Try with another dataset if you had one at hand, and just again, if you want to run this on local, just transfer this notebook to a PY file, and instead to run the notebook like here, import it as a command, import from utils, import star, and you have the same effect that you have here. Okay, that's all. I hope you like it and you find it interesting and useful for your job and training, and as I used to say, it is like that. Give me a like, subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, share with your friends and colleagues, and help me to promote the channel in YouTube. Thank you very much. See you soon.